We've done some kind of radical things here the last couple of years. We've experimented with not even using natural service bulls at all last year, and really trying to do something pretty similar this year, where there's just two rounds of AI exposure, and that's about it.
Today we're with Dr. Jordan Thomas. He's an assistant professor in the Division of Animal Sciences and in Reproductive Physiology. So what does that mean?
Yeah, so Reproductive Physiology would be really the study of how reproduction works in cattle.
Okay, all right. And you're fairly successful with this. You're as a part of a larger group.
Yeah, we've really got a strong reproductive biology group at the University of Missouri that studies reproductive biology in lots of different species. And so I tend to lean into cattle. Obviously, some other folks in our Division of Animal Sciences study reproduction in cattle as well. My program tends to be really applied, so really translational science, trying to do things that, you know, a typical beef cattle producer might use this year or next year or in the coming years. Yeah.
And it's synchronization, the getting them synchronized correct is part of that too, isn't it?
Yeah, we do a lot of that. So control of the estrous cycle hormonally is what we often use to facilitate things like artificial insemination or embryo transfer. And so that's just a really important technology that's kind of our carrier for then how we go use other reproductive technologies.
All right. Yeah. And today you were doing the pregnancy check here at the Southwest Research Center.
Right.
And when this is the, you've what, twice now with AI with those?
Yeah, we have kind of a unique program at Southwest Center, actually, in terms of what we've been studying. So for several years now, we've used estrous synchronization and fixed time AI to start the breeding season. And we've been dabbling with the use of sex-sorted semen to try to generate, you know, specifically heifer calves out of certain planned matings. And that's a really effective technology, a really fun technology to use. The thing that we've started experimenting with in the last couple of years is to do a resynchronization and to do a second AI service at the, you know, a few weeks after the start of the breeding season, so that we can generate even more AI-sired conceptions as opposed to just those that are conceived with natural service bull exposure following AI.
Okay.
And so we've done some kind of radical things here the last couple of years. We've experimented with not even using natural service bulls at all last year and really trying to do something pretty similar this year, where there's just two rounds of AI exposure and that's about it. And so that's a pretty aggressive system, and trying to look at the implications of that for a typical operation.
So what was your percent on the first one then?
Yeah, so that'll vary a little bit based on whether you use sex-sorted semen or whether you use conventional semen, and how the cattle are set up, you know, what protocol they're set up on. So one protocol that my lab has had a lot of success with is this protocol called the 7-7 sync protocol. And a couple of my graduate students worked on that really hard several years ago, and it's been really effective, not just in Missouri, but all over the place. And so with that protocol, we've, you know, pretty typically been in the high 60s to even 70% plus range in terms of first service AI conception rates. So if you think about, you know, getting 70% of the animals to conceive first service AI, that just leaves 30% that haven't. So if we can do a second synchronization on those and get another, you know, half or more of those pregnant, we can very realistically get in the, you know, high 80s or even 90% range with just two AI services. So that's ambitious, and I'm not going to say that that's going to work everywhere in the very first year that you try something like that. But for a herd that's been using synchronization AI for a couple of years and has kind of the snowball effect going already, things are working pretty well already, we can really do quite well with just a synchronization and AI program.
On your cows, I heard very few words say open.
That's right, yeah, yeah.
You're almost 100%, right? Yeah.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah, I mean, it's not 100% because you'll always have some cattle that fail to conceive, and that's just part of the systems that we're dealing with. We're dealing with biology and living things and animals. But we were, I think, in the high 80s to low 90s in terms of our total pregnancy attainment in cows, which is phenomenal if you think about just the fact that all those cows are going to calve as a result of AI, either essentially on roughly the first day of the calving season or just a few weeks later to that resynchronization and second AI service. So tremendous pregnancy.
It's only 2 weeks apart.
Not 2 weeks. It's going to be closer to three naturally. With this system, it ends up being closer to 4 weeks apart. And so that's a little bit of just the caveat there. But even still, that's a tremendous amount, you know, calving out in 30 days.
So, yes, it really is. Now, your heifers, you have a few more opens.
Yeah.
And that's expected.
Well, yes and no. You know, my philosophy on heifer development is different than some folks, but I want to have a heifer development enterprise be independently profitable aside from the cow herd. And so to do that, frankly, we have to be pretty conservative with how we spend money. And one of the ways that we can easily overspend in heifer development enterprises is to spend money on feed resources to develop heifers to pretty high targets. And that's not to say that doing that wouldn't generate really good pregnancy rates. It often would, but at what cost? And so that's the balance. And so what here we have been looking at, again, for a few years is pretty low input heifer development systems where we develop heifers a little bit more on the minimal side, where they are pretty much just grazing and they're really not offered a lot of supplementation to that grazing. And so they're developed to lighter target weights. They enter their first breeding season lighter. And we anticipate that we will have somewhat reduced pregnancy rates in those heifers as a result of that. But we can do that really economically.
Sure.
So some people jokingly call that the Hunger Games. and Eric Bailey and I sort of just take that on the chin because we kind of like the idea that, you know, we can develop heifers pretty economically conservatively here. So we've been doing that, developing more heifers than we need. And developing the majority of the heifer calves and then standing those lower pregnancy rates somewhat. But even still, I mean, you were there when we were preg checking those heifers. It's not like we had absurd open rates. It's
no,
not like,
no. I think five is.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, really not that many.
65, which is not bad at all.
Exactly. Not that many open heifers at all. But, you know, those heifers were more moderately developed than maybe some heifers in the area would be. Mm-hmm. And so just trying to show that system to producers in the area and that, you know, it is possible to develop heifers with a little bit less inputs on the feed side. And in years like this one where feed costs are crazy high, that's something to pencil out.
And economics is where it's at. I mean, at the bottom, at bottom, you can have the most beautiful looking herd, but if you're losing money, it's not good.
That's right. And you know, there's maybe multiple ways to think about that. What is the genetic composition of those heifers is one question, because if you have some really high growth genetics that really need those groceries to get there, a system like this is pretty risky, and you probably would have a lot more open than we have.
Sure.
So packaged together with this kind of system, we've also been trying to move the needle genetically in this herd for a while and trying to moderate their requirements by bringing down cow size a bit and trying to moderate the mature cow size, trying to moderate the mature cow weight and their maintenance energy requirements, and also pushing on some EPDs for maternal traits like stayability, heifer pregnancy, and just things that really we think can keep good, high-quality females in the herd at a lower cost.
And down here in the Missouri Ozarks, that's probably even more important than that we don't have a high feed requirement animal.
Well, I don't know. I think it's pretty important everywhere, to
be honest.
But you know, some environments are tougher than others. And so the kind of cattle that work here may not be the kind of cattle that work in southwest Minnesota, you know?
Sure.
And so it's different from that standpoint. But that economic imperative to moderate costs is still pretty high, really regardless of where you go in the country. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. So my program would have a YouTube channel called Mizzou Repro, Facebook page called Mizzou Repro. We post lots of videos and content there. Also just MizzouRepro.com has lots of articles and things like that
great.
I've written.
All right. Well, thanks so much,
Jordan.
It's been great. See ya.